Actually, I kind of sound geeky in comparison to my colleagues here. I feel the need to redeem myself. So let me tell you why I work for the IOC. It's for the dream and the love of one athlete, this athlete. He's no longer alive, but he managed to transmit the Olympic values to all around him. Believe it or not, never been in Switzerland, doesn't know where Vidi is even, but he managed to really instill those values in all who he sees, he talks to. Imagine this, this gentleman has no media, no communication, probably one TV in the whole village, and still managed to live those dreams and pass them on to his new generation. Actually, if you see this picture here on the right-hand side, this is what's his dying wish, to come to Lausanne and have one photo in front of the rings. Now, 17 years ago, I had no idea where Vidi was. So I found the train station, and there were the rings. And that is the photograph that you see before you. Shameful as it is, but I admit it. This man, by the way, is my father. Ah. And that's why I work for the IOC. Okay? So let me... I know I'm finance, so I hope not to be boring. So I'm going to give you the big picture, and please, you can ask me any question you want afterward. Now, IOC is a non-profit organization. I worked for other organizations which are for profit making. It's not easy. What the IOC does is tremendous for all of you, for the Olympic movement, for the athletes, because they do distribute 90% of the revenues there. Now you scratch your head and say, hey, what about the next 10%? What do you do with that? Okay, I tell you what I do with that. The 10% actually is what brings the revenue in. It pays for the session here. Okay? Some of you actually asked me a question because they saw some things in the media. They say, yeah, Lana, you building an Olympic house, new house. Where'd you get it from? For sure, it's not from the 90%. But let me tell you something else. That is paid by a loan. Okay? It's not cash, it's a loan. And instead of paying rent over four buildings across all the organizations spread across the IOC, the Lausanne area, we decided to come together, but not funding that takes away from the athletes. It is a loan from a bank. Now, of course, I got it at the cheapest possible rate, okay? And that actually is cheaper even than paying rent to someone else. And at least, because we have been here over 100 years and will continue, hopefully, for the future, it will continue for generation and generation after us. This is why. This is the 90%. 5 billion was distributed. These are actuals, so not projections, they are actuals. So I can actually say it. 5 billion was distributed. I will only talk numbers between Olympiads, because this is how we plan our finances. Now, not a single penny comes from government, all privately funded. I want to be very clear. Where it comes from? Now, I just give you an overview. 73% comes from broadcasting rights, 18% top, and there are some smaller ones. Other revenues, sometimes when you pay tickets for the museum or you host certain sessions, that goes in there, OBS, for example. Other rights is when we do licensing, coins, stamps. So it's not as big as everything else. But if you try to remember, these are the two main sources of revenues. I will go a bit deeper. I actually wanted to do a quiz. How many tops do we have right now? 10? 13? Close. 14. Right now we have 14. 13 for this for the last Olympiad. We have 14. You'll get a prize, whoever it is, at the back there. Well done. So we have 14 top partners. You see them there on the screen. Let's go to the next slide. I'll take you to the next slide. We are trying in the IOC and with the president, et cetera, to really have a long-term partnership. This is not for me. This is really for the Olympic movement and for sport and for athletes. This is why we do it. You see a couple of them, two partners go up to 2032. 5 goes up to 28. 9 goes up to 24. And we are in the process of renewing as we speak. You know, the people who work on this revenue and have to get the revenue is coming from the 10%. So actually, in reality, I could say 100% is going to the sport movement and athletes at the end of the day, because I'm not doing it just for my entertainment, or neither are my colleagues, or the people who work in games, or the people who work in sport. Now, they do much more than just providing financial support. For example, I give you an example. Samsung provides phones for the athletes during the game. Toyota provides the cars to get you from one venue to the other, to the athlete village, etc. Bridgestone put the tires on the cars. And I can go on. GE, for example, provided the athlete management system in Pyeongchang to prevent injuries. That's what they do. They really do support the... I used to work for one of these companies, that's why I'm not using it as an example, called Procter & Gamble. But we also used to provide, in my time, lots of support for athletes, because we really, truly believe in the athletes. Now, this is an interesting picture. If you look at... I took a bit of a history, just to show you. Started from 1936. How many broadcasters we had, and what is kind of the scope in terms of territories. You see here, by Rio 2016, as of today, we are global reach, over 500 broadcasters. If you look at the past, maybe we had, even as early as 1984, 156 on the left, and in 1980s, we were about 100. So we are working hard to make sure that the athlete has the platform to really exhibit your performance, your best, and it has a global reach. That is really why. And we are increasing day by day. We are currently at 4.1 billion for the Olympia 2013-16, and will continue to grow. I have a lot of bosses, I have to tell you. I know I call chief finance officer, but lots of bosses. And I'm not complaining. Not complaining about those bosses. Let me tell you who gives me oversight on what I do financially. One, I have an audit committee. Lots of people there, looking at every single number that I have. I have a finance commission, even tougher than the audit committee. Then I have a treasury committee, with external people also sitting there, also monitoring what I do. I have an internal control. I have an internal audit, and I don't know whether Packaret is in the room, ethic and compliance officer to go on top. So when I say that IOC has the highest kind of governance, I really mean it, and I can prove it. I don't have to say it myself. If you look at the right-hand side, PwC says that, my external auditor. Our account, and I don't want to go too technical, is called an IFRS. Legally, I don't have to do it. Why I do it? Because it shows it's a role model for the rest of the organizations all around the world that we really live by governance and the highest compliance and governance standards. So this is what I want to tell you. This is why all of this, with all this background, I want to tell you why I'm able to say that each day I distribute 3.4 million to help athletes and sport organizations around the world. This number, I don't just come up, it really gets audited to a great extent. So when I say it, believe it. I want to ask you a question. If I tell you, by the end of this presentation, you will learn some Arabic, who would say yes? And who would say no? Those who lift, say yes. Few. Okay, it's true, because the numbers, all the numbers you see here, are Arabic numerals. There you go. So by the time this presentation is finished, you have learned some Arabic. You can take that home with you. Now, I will explain how the money is distributed. You saw earlier how the money is coming from, privately funded. Now I talk about how is the money distributed. Actually, 50% of the money, 2.5 billion, goes to the staging of the game. Now you'll ask, why? If IOC doesn't pay this, there is no game. There will be no games also for you to show your best skills and performances. So this is critical. People only talk about the revenues. I hear sometimes in the media, oh, I'll take about, you know, give me some whatever percentage. But there is no revenue without cost. This is cost. The cost that we make to make sure, why? So that we have the platform. Then the second part of it is International Federation, NOC, Solidarity, 1.9 billion. Again, you ask why. Again, for the NOCs and Solidarity is to make sure that really we support the athletes at the grassroots to get them to the game. For the IFs, is to development of sport. Some people ask the question, so, yeah, but okay, you know, I want this and cash. And, yeah, but the problem is with that, is that if you don't invest in sport, not just for the few, but for all athletes, whether they have an Olympic medal, the ones who slightly missed it, or the ones never managed to get to the qualification. It is really, the money is for all sport, all athletes. It's actually, we run on what's called solidarity model, not a business model, solidarity model, to give the opportunities for all athletes all around the world and for sports all around the world to compete at the stage at the Olympic Games. Now, we do a lot more than that, of course. Youth Olympic Games, I will talk about it a bit later on. Actually, there is no revenues associated with Youth Olympic Games. It's entirely funded by the IOC. And why do we do it? It's to make sure the young there is young athletes to become Olympians in the future. We have many additional athlete programs. There are a lot of athlete support within the first parts that I mentioned in the earlier slides, but this is really additional athlete programs. Protecting clean athletes, I'll talk about it later. If we don't do it, here, this money is really going to protect you and all the athletes around the world. We have a responsibility as a head of the Olympic movement in terms of the promoting the Olympism in society and protecting our assets also for the future generation to come. And then some also, of course, support is given there. Now, if I look at some background, none of these numbers, actually, I'm saying as new, they're all in the annual report, they are published, so if you ever want to see them, please reference, go to theolympic.org and look at the financial statement, look at the annual report. It gives you everything that I'm talking about today. If you look here, if you look at kind of the trend, more than 60%, we support the staging, the successful staging of the Olympic game, over 60% if you compare, for example, versus Salt Lake, Pyeongchang versus Salt Lake. It's more than almost also 50% more versus Athens. Now, within the Olympic Charter, the IOC role is to ensure regular celebration of the Olympic Games. Most people think the time we spend there is just during the Olympic Games, but it's actually longer than that. I don't know how many of you know that we start 7 years prior to the game. 7 years prior. And we don't stop until after the game, including my good self here, I continue to make sure whether it's legacy, whether we close with them, whether it's sustainability, or investing in sport in that country, to make sure really the legacy continues on from the Olympic Games. I perhaps ask my colleague James, who's much taller than I am, to talk about what do we provide to athletes during the game.
You can hold it. Thank you, Lana. You'll be hearing more from Lana afterwards. There's a lot more.
I haven't finished.
She hasn't
Please
finished,
don't,
I promise
I know
you.
You're happy to let me go, but I haven't finished.
She hasn't finished, and we're going to jump between ourselves for some of the remaining slides. And first of all, just on behalf of NOC Relations and Olympic Solidarity, I know we've got a lot of contacts with you at the different continental forums that have been held over the last couple of years, and it's a real pleasure to see 185, I saw, NOCs and athlete commissions represented here today, so thank you for that. Just on this slide, one thing we wanted to explain to you is, obviously, all the 10,500 athletes that come to the Games, plus their coaches and entourage, all of those costs are covered through what Lana has just been explaining. It goes from the air tickets that you get to get to the games, the Olympic Village accommodation. Every athlete is guaranteed a bed in the villages and in the accommodation there. Obviously, the dining is open 24 hours a day. And all of that goes on for a period of 5 weeks for the Olympic Games. And then we repeat the exercise for the Paralympic Games. And Kit will talk to you briefly afterwards about the Paralympic Games, or Lana. And then there's different versions, different things. You've got the polyclinic in the village. Lana explained about this Samsung smartphone. And we give access to free tickets for the athletes to go and see other sports. All of this is also designed in very close collaboration with the athlete commissions of the organizing committees. Yesterday, we had the opportunities to sit with the Athlete Commission of Paris 2024, specifically to look at those kind of services that will be available. But again, they're all free for the participants.
You thought you got rid of me easily, right? Earlier. I will also get support from Kit in a moment, so don't clap too soon. So, if you look at the numbers in terms of what we provide to the international federations, I just really wanted to show you in full transparency what the IOC distributes. And you can see here, again, more than doubled. If you look at Rio versus Athens, it's more than doubled. If you look at Pyeongchang versus Salt Lake and so forth, the trend we continue to distribute. It's very important. When I mentioned earlier about the non-profit organization, privately funded, it means if the revenue increases, you know what? I'm not stashing it somewhere on the right-hand side here and leaving it. It really goes back to sport, to development of sport, and to athletes. And everything we do, really, I mean it, the athletes are in the heart of. Personally, I say this, but also across all the administration organization, we keep you in mind. When we go to games, the first thing we think of, what are you providing for the athletes? Where are they going to sleep? Can I look how good this is? And where is the transport? Where is this? And all the things that James was talking about earlier. May I ask Kit, please, to talk about the IF a little bit.
Thank you very much, Lana. And you say you've got a lot of bosses and you feel like people keep a very close eye on how you spend the money. I can tell everyone it's exactly the same inside the house. And I'm sure, James, you can agree with this.
Life is love.
And it's absolutely right, because what you say is absolutely where we choose to allocate every dollar has to fit with us living our strategies and our vision. And being here in front of you today, this is exactly what we do when we set our budgets at the start of the year, when we lay out our strategies about how we're trying to spend the 10% that comes back to the IOC for us to spend. It fits within these strategies. It fits from our side as a sport department, also within the IOC Athletes Commission strategy that Danke outlined earlier, and we monitor that extremely closely inside
actually,
the IOC.
Actually, Kit, I'm glad you mentioned that. I forgot the Plan and Budget Committee on top. And normally when people come in, the first thing they have to explain is what they're going to do with the money. Where does it go to the athletes? So if they say no, say there's the door. So it's very important to also remember this kind of internal process that we have.
I'm glad you forgot the Planning and Budget Committee, because yes, we never can.
I am the head of the Planning and Budget Committee.
In regard to the IFs, the sport department, I think I know most of you. And it's great to see those of you that I have met before and shared some experiences with before. And good to meet those of you who I haven't yet. But just to explain very quickly what we do as the sport department to add some context, you could say that isn't everything at the IOC about sport? And yes, it is in many ways. But specifically in the sport department, we have three main areas of responsibility. First and foremost, looking after you and working with the IOC Athletes Commission to help implement that strategy and support you in what you're doing. And these next 2 days are key for us also to hear that message and work to support the Athletes Committee in the implementation of those actions to bring that strategy to life. The second one is working with the organizing committees that Lana touched on in terms of the planning and the delivery of sport at each of the Olympic Games, summer, winter, Youth Olympic Games also, of course, working hand in hand with our third focus, which is the international federations, the 33 Summer Olympic International Federations we have for the Summer Olympic Games, the 7 Olympic Winter Federations, we have for the Winter Olympic Games, and of course others on the program of the Youth Olympic Games also. The heading of the slide is about sport integrity of the international federations, and we put this very deliberately to really underline the message that when we talk about the financial model, when we talk about the use of funds that are generated through the Olympic Games and driven back, as you said, Lana, $3.4 million every day, that we ensure that there's integrity of the use of that money in every way, at every level. In regard to the international federations, I've been lucky enough to work in an organizing committee. I spent 11 years in an international federation, what is now World Rugby, before coming to the IOC as the sport director. We work with the federations to really make sure that that money is driven back to support you and support the sport itself and the next generation, your successes in your sports. You can see on the slide that we talk about what's traditionally the governance role of an international federation, obviously managing the everyday administration of the sport, ensuring the regular organization of competitions, and I'm sure each of you has seen in your sport how many more competitions the federations are running, thousands of competitions now across the international federations in each Olympiad, each four-year period, and ensuring governing the respect and the rules of the sport. But that's not all. There are two other key areas as well. One is the direct support for you and making sure your sport is clean. Lana will come on to the whole anti-doping model and the financing that we as the IOC drives directly into that, but every international federation is using the money that we pass to them to also drive that clean sport into their own sport. They're also supporting the athletes' commissions, running the events, exactly as you were saying, how we support the Olympic Games, Lana. The international federations are using that money to run their own events, to provide you with accommodation, to provide you with the training facilities, to provide you with the competition venues and the promotion, the broadcast production, the digital and social media promotion of those federations. And then finally, in regard to the federations, they're also doing exactly what James will talk about from our perspective with this Olympic solidarity, and that's developing the solidarity model within their sport. Not just passing the money back to those national federations that are already the most successful, not just passing the money back to the athletes who are already the most successful, but driving that money back in to the development of their sport in all of their national federations, all of their countries around the world, to support that opportunity, to support that pathway, not only for you who have come through that and hopefully experienced it, but also the next generation of athletes, regardless of where they come from in the individual sport.
Great. I mean, it's the same thing that I mentioned for the IFs, is also for the at the national level, NOC and the Olympic Solidarity. Just to make you, I had an interesting meeting one time with one athlete, and they told me, you know what, I'm okay, I'm really happy with Solidarity and NOC. I'm not happy with you, but I said, why? Do you know where the money is coming from? They said, no. It's coming from the IOC. It's the same pot that I'm talking about. So now I'll pass on to James to explain. What do you do with the money, dear James?
Thank you, Lana. Thank you, Lana. So we'll take you just very quickly through what NOCs are. As you can see on the screen here, I mean, we actually just went straight into the Olympic Charter and took some words from the Olympic Charter to explain to you what NOCs do. I am sure everyone in this room knows what a National Olympic Committee does because you've had interactions with them. And we've also got James here, who's actually part of the Australian Olympic Committee Executive Board, who'll take you through a couple of things. But one of the points that that Kit made before is that NOCs are responsible for development of athletes at all levels in their country, in the national country. But not only athletes, also your entourage. And we'll show to you afterwards how the Olympic Solidarity programs have been put in place aim to address that. But the key thing here is that National Olympic Committees have the exclusive authority to take teams to the games. So they're the ones that enter the athletes to the games and then bring them and organize all the operation around that. NOCs are effectively umbrella organizations. They're made up of the national federations. The national federations form part of the General Assembly. National federations, as you know, form part of clubs. So all the different clubs in your countries that you belong to will elect people into the National Federation who will then elect people into the NOCs. So effectively, the athlete as a base is always there, being able to put their voice on the table for what their NOCs, the National Federations, and their clubs do. And I was thinking James could give you a few pointers of how that happens in the Australian Olympic Committee.
Yeah, thanks, James. I just wanted to highlight, you know, the importance of that money coming from the IOC. So I come from Australia, one of the larger NOCs. We've been involved in the Olympic Games since 1896. We've been involved in every Games on the way through. So, you know, a large team, a large NOC. We send 400 plus athletes to the Summer Games. So you would think we'd be well funded, and but in fact, the Australian Olympic Committee receives zero government funding. So even a large NOC like Australia, we don't get any funding from the government. We rely solely on IOC funding and sponsorship funding. So there's all sorts of different models out there with NOCs. Some, like Australia, rely solely on private funding and the IOC. Others will rely quite heavily on government funding. So this model applies to every, it's difficult because it has to apply to every NOC, and there's so many different models out there. But I just wanted to highlight, you know, sometimes you have an impression of a large National Olympic Committee that's well organised, but in fact the funding model can be quite different to what you think.
Absolutely, and we have 206 different National Olympic Committees, going from volunteer organisations all the way up to very professional organisations that can attract private funding, others that work very closely with their government and their ministries of sport to be able to have that kind of funding. One of the things that Kit touched on and Lana is to do with financial control. All the money that goes to the National Olympic Committees is audited. We control it once, we control it twice, every activity that is put out there, we make sure that it is accounted for and audited.
So don't forget, surprise audit.
And surprise
by
audits.
By external auditors.
Yes. We do 40 of those a year. We suddenly arrive and tell an NOC we need to see some additional information on certain programs, and we go into a very, very detailed analysis of what they're doing. What comes out of that often is sometimes they say, well, they don't have enough knowledge in financial management and accounting, and Olympic Solidarity, through some of the programs that we provide, is able to support them on that. Coming to Olympic Solidarity, I hope everyone in the room knows about the Olympic Solidarity Program. It was established back in the 1960s, really to help the newer born NOCs that were coming out of the independent states that were being formed at that time, to help them to provide support to their athletes and get their athletes to the games. It was only really in the 1980s that we were able to get funding in through the broadcast rights. And as Lana showed you before, the money that's available through the Olympic Solidarity programs continues to go up. You can see on the screen what is the exact words in the charter. Those were amended last year at the IOC session in Buenos Aires to include the specific reference to athlete development programs. But as we'll show you, a lot of what we do is athlete-based. On the screen, the main programs that are offered to the 206 National Olympic Committees in the world go for athletes and their entourage. So we have put athletes, again, at the center of all our programs, and we're very lucky because we have Kirsty Coventry and Tony Estanguet on our commission, who have been banging the drum for the Athletes Commission for many years. And so we've been able to adapt our programs for that. In all of these cases, we look at what is the base. We always start from the base and help the young athletes or coaches to develop their skills. And then we go all the way to the elite level. I'll take you through the athlete programs afterwards, but I'm going to just start with a quick video on our Pyeongchang Olympic Scholarship Program to show you exactly how the Olympic Solidarity Programs work, but also the impact that they have. One of the great statistics, before I show you this, that we were told, is in this room, there is 25% of you that had Olympic scholarships at some point in your career. And that is a direct assistance that came through your National Olympic Committee for your training. And for us, we're very proud of that, and we hope you enjoyed it. The video, please.
It's a moment when those who don't have the opportunity to chase their dreams are given a path to help make it happen on the greatest stage in sport. The IOC Olympic Solidarity Scholarship Program has been designed to offer athletes the best possible conditions to prepare and qualify for the Olympic Games, giving them the technical and financial support they need to represent their country and perhaps win an Olympic medal.
Every funding that I get extra was a help towards these Olympic Games and to train in the best circumstances. With the help of the association, we could make it possible to get to the Olympics.
For Pyeongchang, Olympic Solidarity reserved a total budget of $10 million and offered two types of assistance. The individual scholarship includes two key benefits: a monthly grant to assist their training and a travel subsidy to help athletes participate in Olympic qualification events. While the tailor-made option provides more limited support to national Olympic committees, sending the biggest delegations to the Winter Games.
Že je to dôležité hlavne pre krajiny, ako je napríklad Slovensko, ktoré nemajú pre športovcov, ktorí nie sú úplne na vrchole, dostatok financií, aby všetko utiahli. A práve preto je tá olympijská solidarita pre nás športovcov veľmi dôležitá a určite som za ňu vďačná aj ja a určite je to pomoc.
The NOCs are invited to nominate athletes where an Olympic scholarship would have a significant impact on their training and who have insufficient means of funding. Olympic Solidarity analyzes each nomination, working with the international federations to assess their technical merit. The candidates need to have a high enough sporting level to potentially qualify for the Olympic Games and should have taken part in international competitions recognized by the international federations.
Belgium is not a country with a lot of winter sport history. They usually don't give a lot of money to athletes, so I think it's really good that the IOC sees that and says, like, maybe we can support them.
Each athlete is assessed every 4 months, and their participation in the various qualifying competitions is monitored regularly. Then comes qualification and the chance to represent their country at the Olympic Games. In Pyeongchang 2018, 268 individual scholarship holders from 60 national Olympic committees represented their country. Some NOCs use the program in their quest to qualify for the Games. Their achievements are the qualification, participating for the first time, or a personal best. For others, the objective is to be on the podium. And so in Pyeongchang 2018, Olympic scholarship holders won 13 medals and 57 diplomas.
Конечно, я бы посоветовал каждому спортсмену, достойным, который достойно представляет свою страну на международных соревнованиях, использовать такую возможность, если она у него будет, потому что эта стипендия дает больше возможностей лучше подготовиться к самым важным стартам в твоей жизни.
The Pyeongchang scholarships have been designed by Olympic Solidarity to improve the competitiveness of the Olympic Games. The Tokyo scholarship program has already been launched, and athletes are training all around the world on their journey to 2020.
So what you can see on the screen here, I mean, I'm not going to go through every program that Olympic Solidarity has. We have 21 world programs available to all the 206 national Olympic committees. But what you can see on the screen there are really the basis of the support that we provide athletes for their preparation and for their development. The main one, as we just showed you, was really to do with Olympic scholarships. As we said, the Tokyo program has started. The team led by Olivier Niamke, who's here, will be available for any discussions or questions that you have outside at our booth. Some of the interesting things that you can see on the screen here, assisting with career transition is something that was really pushed by the Athletes Commission for Olympic Solidarity to cover, and we're very happy that we've been able to do that. And the last thing, refugee athletes. You'll have seen in Tokyo the first refugee Olympic team that took part in the Games to represent the growing crisis of the 71 million refugees in the world. We, as Olympic Solidarity and the IOC, wanted to really make sure that we were able to afford some kind of protection and some kind of support to the athletes that are in a refugee situation. Just in some figures, we wanted to show you as well. Olympic Solidarity has been operating for many, many years. In the last 4 years, we had 20,000 athletes were benefiting in one way or another from our programs. There was 12,000 specific sport development initiatives that were developed by the National Olympic Committees. That touched, we organized 1,000 technical courses, 1,800 coaches that support you were also offered Olympic scholarships. In total, since Sydney, 6,400 Olympic scholarship holders have been awarded, and 1,300 for the Winter Games. And as I said before, there's 25% of the people in the audience here who benefited from that. So that's Olympic Solidarity Program. I'll pass back to Lana, who'll give you some
okay, you made me happy.
More figures.
Okay, I'm happy with you. So I talked about the Youth Olympic Games. I think I don't need to explain why we do the Youth Olympic Games. It's really to ensure that there are athletes, Olympian athletes of the future. So that's why we invest this. As I mentioned earlier, there are no revenues associated with this. It's just cost. You see some of the costs that we spend on this. This is the number of athletes that participate. We pay for their travel, for their accommodation, for the staging. We are proud to ensure that the youth is for the future, they will maybe be Olympians, or at least they pass on the ideals of sport and the Olympic movement to all around the world. I will not talk about the details of WADA and anti-doping, etc., because I know you have a session later on. I just talk about the numbers and the figures that we, as IOC, invest in this. There is an interesting statement there in green. If you take all government of the world, all of them, give the money to WADA, we match, the IOC matches every single dollar. Isn't that impressive? Shouldn't you actually clap at this point? Okay, so not only WADA, because it's also, we have many other support for athletes and clean athletes. The president mentioned it earlier this morning. We really do work hard to ensure there is sufficiency there. So ITA is set up by the IOC, IOC money. It is an independent, but the beginning of it, 30 million was put into ITA to make sure that it is working in the future for all of you. Also, fight against doping research fund. And so forth. I don't want to mention retesting, testing. I talked about when the game is finished, we still continue in terms of retesting, and that funding has to be there for that, to make sure that really clean athletes are protected. So this is an important investment that we do on behalf of the Olympic movement. If you look at the investment that we give, for example, to IFs, the distribution that I talked about, that there is another chunk comes from IFs, from summer and winter. Every 4 years, about 124 million. So if you actually add up the two together, 260 million goes to fight against doping. That's not a small number. Okay. Kit.
Anna. Thank you. In addition to protecting the clean athletes and ensuring you have confidence in terms of the system and our investment in that, that again we'll touch on, and I think a two-hour session later today. The other investments the Olympic movement are making are really to promote you as athletes, your national federations, your sports, your NOCs, but in particular you as athletes. We launched the Olympic Channel immediately after the Olympic Games in Rio 2016, so it's just over 2.5 years now that the Olympic Channel has been operating. The real reason behind that was, coming back to some of the statistics you gave, Lana, we know how big the audience is for an Olympic Games. We know the billions of people, not just hundreds of millions, but billions of people that tune in to watch you compete on the Olympic stage. But then we wanted to provide something that supported that visibility in between the Games. So it wasn't just 16 days every 4 years for summer and the same for winter. So we launched the Olympic Channel. And when we talk about Olympic Channel, there's a stand outside that can give you more detail, explain what they do, how you can engage with them. But it's not just a channel in the regular sense of flicking through the channel guide. It's really a digital platform designed to be downloaded onto smartphones, and hopefully most of you have, all of you will have by the end of this. But it's really designed to be engaging, reach out to young people, and amplify, promote the Olympic movement, and promote you as Olympians and your sports and your federations on a daily basis. I checked this morning in terms of what was happening on the channel this weekend. The channel not only shows, of course, the highlights and the packages and the promotions from previous games, so you can go back and relive any of those Olympic moments. It not only has documentaries about some of the great moments, some of the great stories, individual teams, individual athletes, but it also promotes your sports and your events on a weekly basis. When I looked this morning, this weekend on the Olympic channel, we've got the Shooting World Cup live, we've got the Badminton Singapore Open live, we've got the Sport Climbing World Cup, the Rhythmic Gymnastics World Cup, the Paris Marathon this week, and in the coming days, the Sailing World Cup and the 3-on-3 Basketball World Tour, all live through the Olympic channel, building on the promotion that your sports are doing to promote you as athletes around the world, and use our platform to extend that as well. We've had over 2.2 billion video views in the last 2.5 years on the Olympic channel, and the average age, 75% of the people that engage with the channel are under 35, so it's really targeted at the young people who consume sport in a digital way around the world. There are opportunities there for all of you, and we'd encourage you to go and speak to the people in the booth to understand that better. The other part of what the channel is doing is running what's called the Sport Data Program. Sport data is becoming more important than ever. You've heard all of the discussions in general society, in general discussion about how important data is now. And in some ways, nowhere is it more important than in sport. We see the changes to statistics, to broadcast graphics, to all of the information. We want to make all of this that is generated through the Olympic Games and through the IOC available to you. So we've launched a project that aims to take all of the data that we generate around you and your performances and your statistics at the Olympic Games, regardless if it's summer, winter, youth Olympic Games, but all of the data related to you that is generated around an Olympic Games, add that into what is generated around your international federations or NOCs, and provide a way to pass that back to you so you can actually use that. You can use that on whatever platforms or promotions you like, on your own ways of engaging with your fans, your supporters through social media, and passing that back to you to use. We're developing that at the moment. We did some testing around it in Buenos Aires last year, and we aim to further that testing in Tokyo. And again, with the guys in the booth in the marketplace upstairs on the Olympic channel, they can explain more about that project to you. But this is just another way in that we're trying to take what we produce and make all of that available to you to promote yourselves in whatever way you wish. And then I think the last part of my section is just talking also about the Paralympic Games. And it's fantastic, as you noted, Danke, to have our partners in the International Paralympic Committee, Athletes Committee here. I think Chelsea and others are here. We really embedded our partnership and our support for the International Paralympic Committee again last year in March when we signed a new memorandum of understanding with them, which is really about not only how we can support each other, but really embedding a spirit of partnership. We work with our host cities through the host city contract in all areas of planning. So there's equal planning put into the Olympic Games and the Paralympic Games, as you see on the screen. We provide financial support on an annual basis to the IPC to allow them to also operate all of the necessary admin support for all of the Paralympic athletes around the world. And in everything we do around the use of our own brand and using all of our platforms to elevate the Olympic brand, the rings, we also try and use those platforms to promote the visibility of the Paralympic Games and Paralympic brand to provide all of that support and recognition for the incredible Paralympians around the world. And there's more, and here I pass back to James.
And there is a bit more, quite a bit more. The promotion of Olympic values and this the concept of building a better world through sport is absolutely part and parcel of what we try to do on a daily basis. We have at the IOC and through the whole network that we have of NOCs and IFs, a wish to make sure that we are building in programs that are doing something good and social in the world. An example is the recently launched Olympic Refuge Foundation, which came out of the collaboration that we have with the UNHCR there, and especially the Refugee Olympic Team in Rio, that gave the issue of refugees a huge visibility across the sporting world. And we have programs that are, that exist specifically to use sport and the network that we have to make sure that athletes that are in a vulnerable position are able to be protected. And there's a number of areas that, such as women and sport and active society that obviously we look at as well. And that's concludes us, but I think James is also going to give you a bit more information.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, James. Thanks, Lana. And thank you, Kit. I think we're all really privileged to have these guys present and detail the funding model of the Olympic movement. And it's something, you know, I've been to six Olympic Games, and I wish I'd know this when I was competing, because you think, you know, as an athlete, you turn up and you compete and you go home and, wow, that was amazing. But you don't realise what's going on behind. I'm not going to talk too long because we actually want to hear what you guys think of all of this. But the number one thing that allows all of this to happen is the revenue. And that's why the infamous Rule 40 is in place, to protect that revenue. And I get asked the question all the time back in Australia, you know, what do you, there's a huge amount of revenue. What happens to it? Where does it go? Why is it important? And it's difficult for me, and it's difficult for my colleagues on the IOC Athletes Commission, because we, you know, I don't represent Australia and I don't represent rowing. I represent all athletes and all sports. And I need to think of all NOCs. So without Rule 40 to protect that revenue, which we know goes into three areas, the organising committee, National Olympic Committees and the federations, without that funding, the Olympic Games doesn't happen. I mean, the beauty of the Olympic Games is that you've got 206 nations coming. It's the only event, we've heard before, it's the only event that brings all the world together. And at the moment, we really need that, because the world's going the other way. So we need to protect that. More than 50% of National Olympic Committees wouldn't be able to get to the Games without IOC funding. So without, if you've only got half the number of countries in the Games don't happen. The same with sports. I don't know what the statistic is, but I know that many sports would struggle, indeed may not even survive without IOC funding. So it's really, really important to understand that that rule is there to ensure that the revenue is available to be distributed to NOCs, to the sports, to actually allow the Olympic Games to happen. So that's really, really important. That rule is being relaxed a little bit from Rio 2016, has been relaxed and shifted to the local level, to the local NOCs, to determine how they want to apply that rule. I mentioned the Australian Olympic Committee. We need to be relatively firm in the application, because we rely on sponsorship to allow the team to go to a Games. Other NOCs, it might be different, but the framework of how that rule is applied is determined by the local NOC. But I just wanted to finish off with, and we do want to hear what you guys have to think about the programs, the funding model, whatever. But like, the Olympic Games are awesome. There's no doubt about that. And the reason that they are is that we've got all of the nations and all of the sports coming together. And without the funding, that doesn't happen. So it's an issue that I'm sure will be discussed, and I wish I knew about all of these issues when I was competing, but I think we're all really privileged, and hopefully now we all understand pretty clearly what the funding model is, where the funds go, and why it is so important. So thank you.